Welcome to the opening session of our Hauenstein Center 2014 Common Ground Initiative program. We have an extremely ambitious initiative. In fact, this is the most ambitious that we've ever had. I'm Gleaves Whitney, and I'm proud to serve as the director of the Hauenstein Center for Presidential Studies here at Grand Valley State University. And I and my staff are going to be hosting you for the next 3 days. And as your host, I have the happy task of expressing a lot of gratitude to people. First of all, I want to express gratitude to our speakers. We've had a number of speakers come in, almost 30 speakers in all, coming in from various places, from two countries and from coast to coast, people who really are very thoughtful. And then we have a lot of local talent who are going to be able to weigh in on this most important topic, the summit 2014, the topic being, have the liberal arts become too politicized, a meeting of minds, left and right? And I mean that, left and right. This is not, I had one skeptical person say to me, is this a setup, you know, for one side to take down the other? It is absolutely not a setup. We are looking, as we always do in our Common Ground Initiative programs, we are looking for a good, rigorous, and respectful conversation. In addition to thanking the speakers, I want to thank our partner, a hearty thanks to Annette Kirk, president of the Russell Kirk Center for Cultural Renewal. Annette, would you please be acknowledged? We couldn't have done this program without Annette's encouragement, enthusiasm, and all of our work over the years, so we're just delighted that the Russell Kirk Center is involved with our program. And then finally, I want to thank our many generous donors, especially the Earhart Foundation in Ann Arbor, Dyer Ives Foundation here in Grand Rapids, and most of all to Colonel Ralph W. Hauenstein, who will be with us tomorrow. He couldn't come tonight, but he'll be with us tomorrow and share in all the festivities. And we thank you for all the support that you've given to the Hauenstein Center and to Grand Valley to make programs like this possible. Well, I want to get right to our program today because we have a couple of all-stars on stage, and especially we have somebody who's flown in for this very special appearance, and I'd like to invite our newest member of the Hauenstein Center team, Joe Hogan, to come forward to introduce our two distinguished guests on stage. Thank you very much. Joe?
We'll begin this Common Ground Summit with a conversation on the liberal arts. Many of you likely remember the old episodes of Firing Line with William F. Buckley, founder of National Review, in which Buckley would converse, sometimes debate, with a distinguished guest. For example, Christopher Hitchens, Noam Chomsky, Norman Mailer. Today, two of our speakers, Eva Brann, distinguished tutor at St. John's College, and Winston Elliott, president of the Free Enterprise Institute, will participate in such a conversation on the topic of Plato's Meno. Mr. Elliott will take on the role of Buckley, while Dr. Brann will be his distinguished guest. Now, tomorrow, Dr. Brann will deliver a keynote address, and then she will receive a more detailed introduction. But for now, please join me in welcoming her and Mr. Elliott.
First off, I would suggest that I have absolutely no ability to do Bill Buckley's mannerisms or accent, so don't have any expectations in that area. It is a pleasure to be here with you. I thank Gleaves and everyone here at the Hauenstein Center at the university for having us. And it's a particularly wonderful opportunity for me to be able to have this conversation with Dr. Eva Brann. It is a pleasure for me as publisher of the Imaginative Conservative, an online journal of thought and imagination, to publish essays by Eva Brann for the last several years. We're very proud to have her as one of our senior contributors. And it's particularly exciting for me to be able to spend this this brief time we have this afternoon talking with Dr. Brann about what we hope will be something on the liberal arts, something on the Meno, and something on the human person. That way we cover everything in the title. I want to just bring up a couple of things that Eva has written about, and you can think about getting these books. Matter of fact, just go ahead and get them. You don't have to think about it. She wrote a wonderful book called Paradoxes of Education in a Republic. And she's also written a number of other works, including a book called What Then Is Time? Homeric moments, feeling our feelings, and she just did a recent translation of the Logos of Heraclitus. And we're very excited that this summer, I guess not too long from now, her newest book, entitled Unwilling, An Inquiry into the Rise of Will's Power in an Attempt to Undo It, will be coming out. For the last 57 years, Eva has been a tutor at St. John's College. And we'll talk a little bit, I think, this afternoon about what that means, why a tutor, not a professor, and a little bit about the St. John's program. I think it's appropriate for us to be here. We published an essay on our journal earlier this week by Tony Esslin, some of you may know him, and he said, if we want to learn how to paint, we stand beside the master who knows more than we do, whose example can show us far more than we can be put into words. So Michelangelo learned from the great but lesser scholar Ghiberti, praising his golden work on the doors of the baptistry in Florence, calling them the gates of paradise. If we want to learn how to be noble, good, great of soul, courageous, and wise, we cannot begin with ourselves. We must find a teacher. I think for the last 57 years, students at St. John's have had the opportunity to have such a teacher in Eva Brann, and for the last several thousand years, many of us have had the opportunity to be the student of Plato in the same way. So welcome, Eva. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you, Winston. Yeah.
I know we have had a lot of conversations, and there's a program for the next 2 days. It's going to be addressing the liberal arts, liberal education, liberal learning. What are those the same thing? Do they have different meanings? Why should we talk about them?
Well, I think that they're different. A liberal education and liberal learning, they're more or less the same thing. Liberal learning is a way of engaging in liberal education. But I think the liberal arts are really distinguishable from liberal education in this way. Liberal arts are skills. They're the skills that you need in order to gain a liberal education. They consist traditionally of the 7 liberal arts, a logic, grammar, rhetoric for the arts of language, various kinds of mathematics, physics, music for the arts of nature. Music is among the arts of nature. Mm-hmm. And you learn them by practicing, by attending to examples. You really need a teacher. The liberal education has to do with, to my mind, with reading books and interpreting them, with knowing how to ask questions, with engaging in a way of life. So I'd say that liberal education is something that can be carried on anywhere at any time. Unfortunately, these days, least of all in colleges, whereas the liberal arts are really, really generally carried on in schools. And to me, that makes a distinction. It's not the world's most important distinction, but.
Mm-hmm. So does liberal learning take place only in institutions? Or?
No, as I was saying, it seems to me liberal learning can take place any place. For instance, one place where liberal learning takes place very richly are the many reading groups that exist all over the country. Groups in which friends get together, read books and talk about them. That's liberal education. Or where people study on their own and find friends sometimes to talk to, but like to read books, think about things. Liberal education and thinking about things, they are practically the same thing and can happen anywhere. That's kind of lucky because, as I said, it doesn't happen very much in institutions anymore. That's, after all, our problem here.
Now, you're part of an institution that is dedicated to liberal learning.
Yes.
Very much a great books program. You're a tutor, not a professor, according
That's
to
right.
title.
Yeah.
Why?
Well, I'll begin by saying why we call ourselves tutors and not professors. Professors are people who profess something. That is, they've got a profession. Presumably, they are authorities. And they quite rightly tell students what to think. We never tell our students anything. And in fact, a friend of mine, you may actually know him, West. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's a classicist. Mm-hmm. He often visited us, and he used to say that our students come knowing nothing, and they leave knowing that they know nothing. Well, in a way, it's true, and we glory in that fact. They do a lot of very serious and difficult work. They learn the liberal arts. They do a lot of mathematics. They learn physics. They read difficult books. They write papers. So it isn't that we futz around and don't do much, but our function is not to tell them, it's to help them, and above all, to ask questions and to teach them to ask questions by example. So we call ourselves tutors. The word tutor means guardian. We are guardians of their learning, but we don't impose our expertise on them. It seems to work.
Now, the primary method of the program is in seminar and in dialogue and discussion.
Yes, yes.
We're going to discuss, as we go along a little bit later,
yes.
the Meno and Plato's dialogues.
Yes.
Why dialogue instead of
yeah,
lecture? Isn't lecture good enough?
Let me say something first about these two kinds of teaching ways that we have. They have to do with the distinction between the liberal arts and liberal education. We have recitation classes. Our students do a lot of translation. They learn Greek. They learn French. They learn to write English and to analyze English. And they prove mathematical theorems. They do experiments in laboratories. So that's done in classes that where the teacher, the tutor, assumes a more directly helpful role. But in the seminar, which take place in the evenings, the reason they take place in the evenings is because the young get very talkative in the evenings. It's not so true if they their elders, but after all, we're not supposed to do the talking. They do the talking. And in the evening seminars, we read books, and we begin them by each seminar by asking questions, and then the students discuss it. And that's really the liberal education center of the program.
And the liberal education would take place in a different way if you stood at the front of the class, as most of us do in our teaching, and gave the lecture?
Yeah, well, I've given lectures myself, and I know that generally they put people to sleep. We want our students to be wide awake, and that only happens if they themselves are engaged in their education. Mm-hmm. So the seminar is a place where everybody participates on an even basis. The tutor's directed in the sense of saying, well, before you argued this, and now you're saying the opposite, why is that? Or they might say, I don't really understand what you're saying, or they might say, that's not the way I read the book, show me why you think that. So, and they might sometimes give an opinion, but you can be sure that when I give an opinion, there'll be somebody who says, Ms. Brann, this doesn't seem right to me. I don't understand that. So it's real equality. And the seminar is about as egalitarian and you might say democratic class as you can find.
And the seminar is always addressing a great text. Can you give us an idea of the,
yes,
of the text you use?
Yes, it's always what we call a great book. And I think what we mean by that is that we're not interested in something being scandalously topical or tendentious or belonging to the excitement of the moment. We're interested in the kind of text that no matter how often you read it and how hard you work at it, you don't get to the bottom of it. And that's the definition of a great text. Mm-hmm. This one is one of the very greatest. That's the Meno we're talking about tonight.
So give us an example of what the students would read in their first year, for instance.
They begin with reading the Iliad, Homer's Iliad, and then they read the Odyssey in English. They're beginning to study Greek, but they don't know enough Greek to do it, to read it in the original. So we do everything in English. So it begins with the two great poems, and then the first philosophical work, the most first dialogue they read is the Meno, and that's, so to speak, our secular Bible. We live by that dialogue.
Mm-hmm. So we're talking about the Meno, and most everyone remembers that the Meno begins with Plato being asked,
Socrates being asked,
so what is virtue?
Yes.
Or in another translation, what is human excellence?
Yes.
Now, Socrates is a great teacher. He's been teaching on the streets of Athens for many years by this time. Mm-hmm. Why can't he just answer that question? Couldn't it be a lot shorter if he could just write it out?
He claims that he doesn't know. And Meno says it in an outraged sort of way, Socrates, you want me to go? He lives up in the provinces in the north. Do you want me to go home and tell people that you, Socrates, don't know what human excellence is? And then Socrates undertakes to show Meno that Meno really doesn't know, and what's more, that he doesn't care. It's very important. Our students haven't read any background. We keep them away from that kind of thing, because every time you read a background that might be an introduction or a commentary or an interpretation, what it really does is, and what the intention is, to keep you away from reading the thing itself. So we ask our students, we show our students that we don't want them to have background knowledge which they bring in. But sometimes it makes sense to do it. There is a contemporary of Plato, Xenophon, who wrote a history of a campaign that the Greeks were on in Persia. And the general there is Meno. And it turns out that Meno is about the nastiest person you would want not to be friends with. In fact, what Xenophon says of Meno is that it was worse to be his friend than to be his enemy. Well, in this dialogue, Meno is simply someone that Socrates talks to. A great question we sometimes pose to students is there something in the dialogue that tells you that this man is really bad? And it makes for a very interesting discussion. I think the keenest students usually think that they can discover that. And the reason, the way that he shows himself to be bad is that he asks a lot of questions and doesn't care the least about the actual answer. What he wants is a free lesson from Socrates in rhetoric, which he has to pay, at home he has to pay for that kind of thing. You know, the so-called sophists were rhetoricians who received pay for teaching such things. What is virtue? What is vice? What is greatness? What is happiness? Well, he thinks he comes to Athens and he's going to get Socrates to give him that for free. But what the actual answer might be is of no interest to him. Then something wonderful happens, you'll remember. Meno poses a question for Socrates. Shall we get into the text?
Yes.
Socrates has just shown him that he really doesn't know what he's, he doesn't even know what he wants, he doesn't know what he's talking about. He doesn't know how to answer Socrates' question, which is to tell him what kind of a thing it is he's looking for. And then he says to Socrates, look, Socrates, how will you ever look for anything? If you already know what it is, you don't need to look. Mm-hmm. But if you don't know what it is, how will you know when you find it? Yeah. So, and then he thinks he stumped Socrates. Great victory. And Socrates turns to Meno's retinue. He said, is there a member of your household who knows, who speaks Greek? And Meno produces a little boy who's a slave, Greek slave. He says, he was born in my household, he knows Greek, but he doesn't know anything else, he doesn't have an education. And Socrates shows that this boy is capable of discovering something that he didn't know before. Mm. And that's a great demonstration.
Yeah. I think it's interesting in this that, of course, he starts by asking, Meno starts about asking virtue, about virtue, what is it? And the Socrates replies with saying, well, I don't really know what it is. Matter of fact, I don't know anyone that really does know what it is.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure, it implies or says, pretty sure you don't know what it is, but you're asking about it, and at least that's interesting.
Yes.
But then he goes on to induce Meno to make, to answer a series of questions about, well, what is it something good? And if it's something good, what is a good to you?
Yes.
And then he proceeds to go on and talk about procuring wealth and health and these things that Meno would say are good. And then he really kind of flips on him and says, okay, but if you are able to procure these goods, wealth, health, fame, but you do them without, essentially you do them dishonestly, are they still good?
Yeah. Every answer, I think it's exactly the way you've said it. Every answer that Meno gives, Socrates always wants to know, well, if human excellence consists in knowing how to get rich, is it getting rich honestly or by cheating? And Meno really thinks it's by cheating, but he doesn't admit that, right? He has to say, well, it's by being honest, right? Mm-hmm. And Socrates points out that getting rich was not human excellence, but being honest and just as human excellence. That's one problem. The other problem is that Meno never understands what Socrates asks. He turns on him and he asks, what is the thing itself human excellence? And Meno always produces any number of answers. He says, well, there's a woman's excellence, there's a man's excellence, there's a little boy's excellence. Mm-hmm. And Socrates says, no, I didn't ask you about various ways of being good. Mm-hmm. I ask you what the goodness itself is. And Meno, it isn't that he doesn't know the answer. No, nobody in the dialogue, I think Socrates actually knows an answer. Mm-hmm. But that's not the point. The point is that he doesn't even understand what's being asked for. And that willingness to understand the question and to think about what something is, that for Socrates is what thinking is about. Yeah.
So is the drama of this dialogue and the other dialogues of Socrates, is the drama in the conversation, the thinking, the exchange, the actual kind of process of watching people not get it, and try, in some cases, in this case, even trying not to get it, because if I get it, I have to admit that something I want to believe isn't really true.
Yeah, there's a wonderful double drama, and almost all the dialogues have that. One part of the drama is pursuing the truth, which the question leads to. I have my own theory about it. Nobody needs to believe it, but I'll tell you. And I think that in every dialogue, we are actually led to an answer. It's not just sort of an endless and infinite futzing around. It comes, it gets somewhere. But it's not said explicitly. The drama is in showing that various immediate answers that people say off the top of their heads don't work. That's Socrates' great, one of his ways of talking, talking with people, to show them that what they've just said isn't what they really believe, and it doesn't really make sense. So a lot of it is this testing out of things and showing that people don't know what they're saying. That's a drama, and it's if you're in a mood, it's quite exciting. The other drama is that people's characters show up in this way, whether they do this with resistance, or whether they do it with enthusiasm, whether they're pleased if it's shown that they don't know what they're talking about because they've learned something, or whether they're disgusted with that and with Socrates. Meno is disgusted with Socrates, he's disgusted with him. So you've got both the drama of the argument and the drama of the character of people. Each of the dialogues that are the most interesting ones show people's way of being.
Mm-hmm. It's in this commentary on Plato's Meno by yes. Jacob Klein, who was yeah. your mentor.
He was my teacher. Yeah.
And he has a lovely note in this book. He says, the final version of this book owes a great deal to the care of Eva Brann.
Yeah, that's great. I'd forgotten that. That's very nice, yeah.
But and in this, he talks about the recreative effect of the dialogue. In this case, we're talking about Plato's dialogues, but I think you would make the case that this happens if you're doing the Iliad and the Odyssey, or any of the great texts.
How do you
text.
Mean recreative?
This idea that the participants, and we now, are essentially almost recreating the drama, the dialogue in the present.
And that oh, you that's mean by the, talking about
by
it?
By talking
yes,
about it
absolutely.
And listening to
yes.
it and thinking
yeah.
about it.
Yeah.
Even though this dialogue happened thousands yes. of years ago, we're still participating in it now.
Yeah, and one way to put it, recreating is a way one could put it, another way to put it is that in every dialogue, there are the people, there's three kinds of people, usually. First of all, the people who are actually named, who are talking to each other. Mm-hmm. Then there are usually a number of people who are named, by the way, who don't say anything or only say one or two sentences. So there are usually a lot of people standing around and sort of smirking or laughing or looking confused. There's an audience mm-hmm. right in the dialogue as Plato wrote it. And then there's us. We're the third kind of audience. In other words, the dialogues are really written to be talked about. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is that part of what you would consider to be the power or the strength of the program of discussing great texts at St. John's, that not only are they reading the great writers of the past, but they're actually in a way conversing with them?
Yes, well, and what's interesting is that our students, especially in the freshman year, are thrown right into two very different ways of doing it. The Platonic dialogues are, exactly as you said, are actually written to include the reader as a part of the dialogue. I mean in this way, Socrates will say something that doesn't seem logical, even though his logic is what he uses to disprove other people's opinions. He'll make an argument that doesn't seem quite right. Well, the dull and pedantic interpretation of that is that Plato didn't know logic, which is But I think the right interpretation, or better one, is that that's a place where the reader is intended to say to himself, what's Socrates doing here? Why is he misleading him? For what purpose? And then the dialogue assumes an entirely different atmosphere, because you're in it and you're seeing that Socrates has something in mind, which depends on the reader understanding that this isn't the way to go. And sometimes the person he's talking to will get it, and sometimes they won't, and it'll make a difference. So on the one hand, there are the Platonic dialogues in which you participate in that way as another member of the conversation. But then very soon afterwards, they read tragedies and they read histories, and they all have their own ways of being approachable. But then they begin to read Aristotle, who writes treatises. And that's a very different way of being drawn into a work. He tells you what's what. Aristotle knows. And you have to make out for yourself what the difficulties are and how to carry on with the argument. So they learn as freshmen that there are different ways of writing a book and different ways of participating in a book. One is as another part of the book, as a member, so to speak, of the book, and the other one is as an auditor who has to take it in and critique it internally and in conversation.
When in this conversation that Socrates is having with Meno, and he's talking about wealth and the importance of having it, but at the end he brings Meno to say, yes, but if you didn't get it justly, it's not good. It's not part of that human excellence. Yeah. Is that part of the discussion that we're going to have, hopefully over the next couple of days? There's this whole question about the marketability of the liberal arts. Yeah. And is marketability part of human excellence?
Look, it's part of human survival, mm-hmm. and therefore it has a certain value. But it has about as much to do with education as, well, I can't even think of anything that has less to do with education than that. There's an important distinction, I think, to make. There is certainly vocational training. Every human being has got to be competent in some ways. You know, got to learn to do things that people want done and that you get paid for. Among other things, you have to eat. And our jobs become interesting only if you know what you're doing. Otherwise, it's just misery. So there is certainly such a thing as training. But there's a big difference between training and education. I think everybody, every human being needs to be trained in some way to be good at something. And our students, you know, when they leave us, they go to graduate school, or they go to professional school, or they go into business. Many of them start business on their own, and then their training starts. Because if you're well educated, then training is not so difficult. You learn things quickly. So they learn every kind of thing. We have a number of people who start restaurants. It certainly is a hard life and takes a lot of acuteness and know how to do things. Some become craftsmen. For a while, a lot of them became bartenders for some reason. It's not my favorite profession for them, but they were presumably good at it. You name it, our students do it. So training is certainly something worthwhile that you need. And it's a very respectable way of learning. But a liberal education is for an entirely different purpose. It's a good beginning for vocation, but it's not, it's incidentally useful, is the way I like to put it.
So
incidentally,
from
a liberal education, you become a good learner of whatever you want to do.
So what is the purpose of liberal education?
Well, it's, look, this may sound frivolous, but I'm dead serious about it, is to make life interesting. Because I personally think that a large number of the miseries of the world, be that violence or bigotry or whatever, come from people being bored and not being able to approach things as if they were of deep concern, not knowing what to do with themselves. Whether that's because they're out of work or because they hate their work. So boredom, I think one could make an argument that boredom is at the bottom of a lot of evil that goes on in the world. There are, of course, there are revolutions and that kind of thing, which are the result of mistreatment, of injustice. That's a different matter. Mm-hmm. But making life interesting for oneself is and should be a result of being liberally educated. I think one could argue that it's the main thing. To be there. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So to be present in a way that's yes. beyond the yeah. mere utilitarian pleasures of the moment.
Yeah, that's a very good word, actually. Mm-hmm. To be, when you're there, you're really there, you're present. Mm-hmm. You know how to find the mystery in things. You know how to find, once in a while, the truth of things. Or if you don't know how, at least you know how to begin. And also the something else that happens is that things connect with each other. You know, there's that famous saying, only connect. It's Forster, I think, comes from one of the novels. What he means is know how things hang together. Know, for instance, what the connection between, I'll give an example, which is very interesting to me, between theology and physics is. Right? I mean, that's what makes the early works in physics, Newton's Principia, for instance, were works of theology. You might then come to the conclusion there's no connection, but know at least that this is a subject. And, you know, given more time, I can make you a list of connections that are interesting. Yeah.
So when we're talking about liberal education, liberal learning, liberal arts in a way being a subset of liberal learning.
Yeah, yeah. I would say an enabling introduction, yeah.
So we have this set of tools that are available. Would you say they're available to everyone? Can anyone be a liberal artist, regardless of their particular talents or abilities?
Yeah, I think that on people who haven't had the advantage of a good liberal arts training, education, and beginning of an education. Often learn things on their own. I mean, there are people all over the country learning mathematics on their own, learning logic on their own, learning how to read well on their own. So one can do it on one's own. One can pick it up as one goes. In other words, I think myself that although the liberal arts are a necessary way necessary knowledge for being liberally educated, one can also do it without. And lots of people all over the country are engaged in liberal education with very minimal. You need some skills. You have to be able to read. Right? You have to be able to figure some. But with very minimal engagement in the arts, I think one can become liberal education. And the great sign of this is how all over the country there are reading groups. You know, people read things, talk to each other about them. And
so is it possible for a republic, and you wrote your book on education in a republic, and you talk about the benefits of education in a republic. Yeah. Is it possible for a republic which requires the results, the abilities that come with liberal learning, to survive, to flourish when, for instance, 7% of college students take any humanities courses? I mean, beyond the, you know, one or two gen ed requirements they might have?
Well, yeah, it's possible, but not, look, I'll tell you how I imagine this going on. People who miss that kind of education, it doesn't actually have to take place in the college years. It can take place anytime. They often feel some sort of lack, and then they become interested. It might be that they join a religious community, or they find friends to do it with. So it's the fact that it's no longer generally done in the schools does not mean that it can't come back or be done in other places. That's the most optimistic view of it. I have other views about it too.
So we're going to spend a couple of days talking about liberal learning, liberal education, particularly higher education, and both the impact of the marketability question, but also the impact of political ideology essentially insinuating itself within the university. How does that affect what you do at St. John's?
It's absolutely impermissible. You could call it a crime against education to introduce political opinions into the classroom from the authority, the teacher. Mm-hmm. It's not our business to tell people what to think. And this whole business of the politicization of the college classroom, and to some degree in secondary education, I find it so repugnant I can hardly express it. We do not permit it. Only once in all my years at the college, 57 of them, mm-hmm. Did we have a young, very young man who set up a table in our coffee shop, which is where everybody talks about everything together, in which he was advocating some cause or other. I forget what side he was. It doesn't make any difference what side he was on. And shortly after, we no longer had him with us. We told him he had to stop it. He didn't want to stop it, so he left. You can't, it's against the very notion of liberal education as a kind of conversation with people who know a little bit more than you, but who are essentially on the same level as you are and wanting and having the same desire to learn, that they should use their position to tell you what to think. That's exactly what liberal education isn't. I think all my colleagues have political opinions, all the ones that know. Often takes me years to find out what they really are, but they hold them strongly, and they know the difference between engaging in a conversation, raising questions, and telling people what they think the truth is, which is just their opinion. I think it's true that our faculty in particular has all the sides represented. I have colleagues who I know are fairly conservative, and I have colleagues who I know are very liberal, but it doesn't get into the classroom, and it shouldn't. And that it ever happened in the universities is a real, real tragedy, and partly has to do with the fact that university education, the value of it has declined. Mm-hmm.
How does that work in terms of your students? Because nowadays, at least what we see in the news, what we see in common social media culture, is there's a heavy emphasis on the political, and on particular on choosing sides. I'm the red team, you're the blue team.
Yeah.
We're gonna get out our cheers, and we're gonna yell at the other players, and we have to call them idiots or fools, or we really haven't done our job describing them.
Yeah.
How do the students who come into your room essentially set that aside when that is a prevalent?
Yeah. Well, you know, students generally become politicized in the college or in the university. They don't come that way. So it's not a big problem. But they soon, if there is someone who has strong opinions, and we have students who are strongly and very or very seriously conservative, for instance. Well, they're perfectly free to publish their opinions, and they do in student newspapers, mm-hmm. and others are perfectly free to oppose them, not in the classroom and not from their teachers. Mm-hmm. In other words, the world is full of politics. Why shouldn't it be? Mm-hmm. But not when something great, even greater than politics. Politics is an enormously important human mm-hmm. matter, but there are things that are even greater, which is trying to find the truth, and we don't let opinions interfere.
Is finding the truth political?
No, what you find may be a political truth, yeah. But the activity, it seems to me, is not political, or it oughtn't to be. I think that people have conservative and liberal approaches to learning, but that's not yet a dogma, right? That's merely a way of being. Some of our students are very respectful of tradition, and they worry about things changing, and one might call that conservatives. Those are full of rebellion. Mm-hmm. Well, these are perfectly legitimate human approaches, but the question is, are you listening to the other side? Are you considering all the possibilities? And it's not the teacher's business to drive anyone into one or the other camp. Mm-hmm. And by the way, I would be very sorry to think that any of my students know what my private opinions are. You know what my private opinions are, mm-hmm. not my students.
Now, you publish quite a bit, and you have students who I assume would read some of your outside publications. Do they ever come back to you and say, I didn't know you
they
thought
don't
that?
Read, or? They don't read my stuff.
Oh, that's terrible.
To do. I don't, look, shall I tell you a story?
Sure.
It just happened 2 weeks ago. It's a little bit off the point, but it's not off the point of what an education is. I've been teaching freshmen, you know, and among my freshmen, there is a young man who is from the Midwest, very modest, very sort of reticent, but very acute, and very, really, really interesting. And in the course of the year, you discover that because we make our students talk. So when our end of the year evaluations came, we evaluate all the students orally. You know, we sit with them, all their tutors sit with them and tell them. My colleague, you know, all our seminars have two mm-hmm. teachers in them, so that no one will get away with anything. And we said to him we thought his performance was very fine. And he said in a sort of modest way, he comes from a small place called Eden Prairie, and I forget what state it is. So obviously in this very small high school, he said, no one's ever told me that before. And that evening before seminar, I called him aside. I said, I want you to understand that when we praised your performance, we didn't just mean your performance, we meant your way of being. And he looked at me sort of shocked, he didn't know what I meant. And I said, do you understand what I'm saying? He said, no. He said, yes, I understand it. Then we you know, summer began, and three or 4 weeks later, I got a letter from him, and I said, Miss Brann, you know, I have two questions. One is, what did you really mean? I really didn't understand. So I explained to him that I meant, look, you go about learning in a modest way, and you're very acute in what you do, and we meant that you're a great learner and you're in the right place. I wrote back to him. And the second question was, what book of yours should I read? He was clearly rewarding me. And then he said, very wisely, he said, I know what you're going to say. You're going to say, don't read a book by you, but read a great book. And I said to him, you're exactly right. But then I couldn't resist. I sent him my latest book. But that's the answer. They don't generally, and we don't encourage it. And no one is ever required to read anything a tutor has written.
You brought up a term that I don't know that I generally hear used in higher education very much now. You said modesty. That it seems like we're not allowed to be modest in our views or in our instructions or in our arguments. We have to be very
noisy
and bold. Yeah. And and of course, that's part of Socrates in this dialogue and another dialogue saying, well, I don't know. And I'm not sure that I've ever known. But let's talk about it. Yeah. And the conversation never ends there.
Well, the difference between that is that we really don't know. And Socrates, that's what's called his irony. Mm-hmm. He's often pretending. And as I say, my own private interpretation of the dialogues is that almost every dialogue, he actually knows the answer. I'll tell you what I think he thinks, what the answers that he gives in this dialogue, in the Meno. Mm-hmm. The question is, what is human excellence? And it's clear that Meno is full of false notions about it. And then he, as I said, he calls out this little slave boy, and he elicits from him the answer to a very deep mathematical problem, namely how to find the double square, you know, giving a square of, say, a square foot, how to find a square, the length of a square, which is equal to 2 square feet. Now, the reason that that's such a fundamental problem is because it involves the notion of irrationals. Mm-hmm. And it turns out the answer is on you draw the diagonal, and the square on the diagonal is the double square, and this diagonal has an irrational relation to the side, another which means you can't express it in numbers. One of the most fundamental discoveries in mathematics ever. And this little boy discovers it, not that he himself knows how to ask the right questions, but when Socrates asks some questions, he thinks about it seriously. When he goes wrong, he admits it. And when Socrates points it out to him, he looks at it and he considers it. And out of his own knowledge, deep knowledge, which he didn't know he had, he knows that this is the right answer. So the answer to the question, what is human excellence, is being like that little boy, willing to learn. And you, Meno, haven't got it at all.
So we've found the place for liberal education. The place for liberal education is to really, honestly, with humility, want to know the truth.
I think that's right.
And that there is a truth to be known.
Yeah. Look, it's not always wanting to know the truth. Sometimes it's just wanting to know the circumstances. Yeah. In other words, you may not get the truth. Sometimes you get to something which you think is the truth, but wanting to say what you really yourself can believe, in other words, not faking it, mm-hmm. that's certainly major element.
You wrote a beautiful collection of essays called The Music of the Republic, Essays on Socrates' Conversations and Plato's Writings.
Yes.
And in that, you end one of your essays with, first attend to the adjustment of your own soul, particularly the regulative liberal learning of your intellect. Then project your internal economy on the world as social and political justice. The other way around is headless.
Yes. Did I say that?
Yes, you did.
That's not a quotation.
No.
Well, okay.
So you didn't know how good you were? You really was very
well,
good?
I said so many things.
Well, I want to...
Yeah.
Okay. I want to, before we take some questions, because the director is telling me to take some questions.
Mm-hmm. Okay, take questions.
Just say that one of the great pleasures of reading, or my pleasure in reading Plato is greatly enhanced by reading it as with your book as a companion. And I had an opportunity this summer to spend time reading your book, Homeric Moments, which is a collection of essays on reading Homer, both the Iliad and the Odyssey. And I read that while reading Homer, while listening to, I forgot the actor's name, Gandalf, as the reader on the audio version.
You did all three things at once?
All three simultaneously.
And I call that multitasking.
Well, not at the same moment.
Good.
I divided them up. But it was just a marvelous opportunity because that Homeric Moments, I think, and you'll talk about the Odyssey tomorrow.
Yes.
Is just an incredibly rich text. So many of you already know that, but when listening to it with a great actor, and then supplementing it with essays that kind of point you into places that you might not have known to look, from someone who's been looking at it, in Eva's case, for 57 years, I think it was a marvelous opportunity. So I want to thank you for being my companion with Homer and with Gandalf.
Thanks for telling me. Yeah.
For that time.
Yeah.
So we had questions, and I gather there's a mic. There's a mic.
Check. Great. For the question of the audience portion, we will run the mics to you guys. So just raise your hands, and we'll hold it for you, and you can ask your question. Number one.
Hi, I'm Bill Rice with the National Endowment for the Humanities, although my question is not necessarily reflecting the views of the National Endowment for the Humanities. So my question is this, slave boy in the Meno always struck me as an extraordinarily powerful and radical moment for me as a reader in my time, and I think it's taken that way by education writers often.
Yes.
Is it meant to be such within its own context is one question, but I'll ask a grand generalizations question. Is it fair to say, in fact, that the great books, by and large, are documents of dissent, documents that are meant to challenge a prevailing order, that are animated by some spirit of rebellion? Is that a fair generalization?
You know, that's a really interesting question. There are certainly such documents. Shall I give an example? Aristotle, I'm thinking about the ancients now, moderns, different matter altogether. Aristotle, in his Politics, says that there is such a thing as natural slavery, right? And what he means by that is that there are certain human beings who simply lack the power of judgment and who have to be under someone else's control. Scholars, and sometimes our students, take that to be an acknowledgement and agreement with the institution of slavery among the Greeks. To me, it seems absolutely the opposite. It's an act of real dissent, because the slaves, like the little boy in this dialogue, they were mostly Greeks and the children of Greeks captured in war. There was absolutely nothing of the sort that Aristotle is thinking about, no sort of deficiency. The slavery that Aristotle knew was not natural slavery. And I think myself that this understanding of slavery that he advances is intended to show that the institution of slavery as practiced among the Greeks is absolutely illegitimate. That's an act of rebellion, and in this case, rather cleverly introduced. But there are also great writers who have very conservative intentions, which are to show that the way things are legitimate, and to give a deep underpinning to legitimacy. And the best example of that is Hegel, who shows that the development of history reaches a certain high conclusion, and who finds that, as it happens, in the Prussian state. That's as conservative one get on very deep grounds, not on traditional grounds at all, but on deep metaphysical grounds. So I think it could go either way. Is that, I mean, would you agree with that?
Have other questions?
You talked about how great, when we read great texts, that no matter how hard it is, that we never get to the bottom of the answer. Could you explain that? And is that surrounding the way that we think? Or if we really reflect on a thing, mm-hmm. because a lot of times we just answer stuff mm-hmm. without processing information?
Yeah. Look, I want to begin by saying that this kind of education and this kind of inquiry is not heavily information-based. You know, it's always better to know something than not to know it. But there is such a thing as being too addicted to facts and not leading you anywhere. But as far as the main point of your question, which I understood to be, do you ever get anywhere? I think you get to, they're sort of staging points. You have an illumination. You say, this is the way it probably is. For instance, in this dialogue we were talking about, I think anyone who reads this experiment with a little boy will say, there are certain things that we don't know, and we don't even know what we're looking for, but we can somehow or other dredge out of ourselves an answer. And that answer is not an end, but a very good beginning. And then you go on. And in that way, you can discover a lot of things, but you're never at the bottom. That's not, at least as far as I know, not any of the great books that I've read get you to some place where you can really rest. So it isn't a kind of wishy-washy going on and on with no without getting anywhere. You get somewhere, but then there's always more. The more is on a different level from where you came from. That's the way I deal with that question. Does it help? Okay.
Okay, I have a...
Dr. Brann, I have a question that relates to some of the work that you've done at St. John's. I think an argument that people might make, perhaps even against a great books program, is that really students, if they're entering into a field, for instance, literature, they really ought to know what's being said right now and what thinkers, which thinkers are being read right now. And I do think I was fortunate at Grand Valley to have a lot of professors who taught taught the ancients, but I do think I actually ended up reading much more Derrida than I did Socrates yeah. or Plato. yeah. And I'm just wondering how you might, or anyone at St. John's might respond yeah. to that argument.
Look, is your question, is this a version of your question that we don't pay enough attention to modernity?
I think that's something that someone might say, yes.
Yeah. I would say that one of the characteristics of our times, of modern times, is that it is, in some important ways, a consequence of notions that were developed earlier in early modernity, and those in turn were developed in contrast to antiquity. And that in order to get to what is of great interest to us, you have to have thought through some of the things that came before, not because they came before, but because they're still active now. And the main, some of the main notions that are involved in the way we conduct our lives are really the ghosts of things past. That's one answer. Another practical answer is that our students read a lot of 20th century science and philosophy. And we haven't got into the 21st century, but there hasn't been much of it yet. So it's in a practical way not quite true, yeah, that we stick only to ancient things.
I myself was
trained as a classicist, and so I so naturally have a bias to the ancient. I think it's probably more than a bias. But I spent most of my time studying modern stuff.
When you look at it, you remember this section of the Meno. Why do I say you remember? Of course you do. That where they're talking, the discussion gets into the existence of evil, and whether Socrates is asking, you know, does he believe that people ever do evil intentionally, knowing that the outcome will be evil? Certainly, that is a modern question, as much as it was a question 3,000 years ago.
And Socrates has a very, this is something, he has a very definite opinion on that. Mm-hmm. No one ever does knowingly evil. This is really interesting. And in this book on the will that I've just completed, it becomes a very central question. You know who invented doing evil knowingly? I think one could argue Augustine. It's a Christian notion, namely, that there's a devil. Yeah. A devil is someone who knows he's evil and does it because it's evil. I don't know, in Paradise Lost, the fallen angel, Lucifer, now Satan, says, in a very dramatic moment, he says, "Evil, be thou my good." He acknowledges that it's evil for evil's sake. I think the ancients didn't have that idea very much. It's an interesting break in the tradition.
Is it correct that Plato taught that the ends of education were wisdom and virtue? That the ends of education were wisdom and virtue, implying that he wanted to teach that there were ends. Is this conflict with anything you say or teach?
Yeah, look, is this a way to understand that? I don't mean to revise everyone's question, but...
That's fine.
An educated person is also a good person. And well, the wisdom comes, everyone would agree that some wisdom has to come with education, but that education also shapes the character. And I think that's absolutely what Socrates thinks. That, but there's a but to that. And I take this from the long dialogue called The Republic. The notion that if you undergo a real liberal education, you become a good person has to do with the notion that virtue is knowledge. Mm-hmm. Yeah? Mm-hmm. That's what determines it. If it's true that to be good means to know something, and really to know it, then of course education is the way to goodness. Mm-hmm. And I think that's exactly what Socrates thought. I'm not so sure that Plato thought it, but Socrates thought it.
Thank you.
We did publish a very interesting essay, if you were interested in pursuing it. Dr. Luis Marcos from Houston Baptist University wrote an essay for us entitled Socrates' Mistake, Knowledge is Not Really Virtue.
Yes, he denied that.
Yes.
That's,
yeah.
Yes. Yeah. It's a very doubtful matter, yeah.
There was one over here. I don't know if you saw. Right down here, Gleaves.
Oh, there we go.
He's hiding behind the wall. Yeah. He's coming out of the cave. We can see him now.
Thank you. This was lovely. I'm wondering if you might spend a few minutes reflecting for us on the connection between material things and the kind of learning that you advocate and feel so passionately about. I mean, you've said, I think, very eloquently that the purpose of a true education is not to learn a skill with which you can then earn money. But I'm wondering if you can comment on the material conditions that you see as essential for undergoing the kind of education that you favor. It dawns on me that though it's often folks who are on the right who advocate a kind of great books approach, that there's a way in which the ideals of the great books model in fact provide a strong argument for the existence of something like an educational welfare state, in the sense that it is almost impossible, I think, for students to undergo any of the kinds of experiences that you've described among your students if they are saddled with enormous student loan debts and have to work multiple jobs to pay their way through college because of tuition hikes and reductions in state higher education budgets and so on. And so I'm wondering if you can get a little bit more into the nitty-gritty of the relationship between these things.
There's a tradition about this which seems to me to be largely right. Leisure is the condition for learning. You can't learn if you're harassed by money troubles or health troubles. So it follows that having sufficient wealth is necessary. And usually it's not, with our students, it's not their wealth, it's their parents' wealth. So I would say that there is a real connection between liberal learning and a certain amount of affluence. And that goes way back. Aristotle says that it's when people began to have superfluity so that they didn't need to labor that the liberal arts began, with astronomy, which he thinks is the first liberal art. So I have no illusions about the need for enough. Now, here's an interesting question. Is great wealth a bar to liberal education? Is it? I don't know. Look, my experience with great wealth is from, what seems to me great wealth, is from our board members, who seem to be, in spite of being rich, very interested in learning. So I don't think it's a bar, but it's a danger. I think the middle degree is right. If someone offered me huge wealth, would I say no? Probably not.
I would recommend that for those of you not familiar with Eva's writings, certainly her books, and also on our site, The Imaginative Conservative, we published probably a dozen essays by Eva, and we're very happy to have them. And that would, if you wanted to get an introduction, that would be a good place to start, because they're available online for free. And then the books are marvelous.
And then the essay that sets out why I think of myself as a kind of conservative. Mm-hmm. It's called the Imaginative Conservative. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Let's give him a hand. You know, I've got to say, I think that's the longest sustained applause that we have ever had for a speaker. And I think for both of you, it was just a wonderful virtuoso performance. Winston, you did a great job playing William F. Buckley. You're better at it than you thought. That's right. And Eva, thank you so much for your insight and your example as a teacher for all of us who are in the classroom. This was a clinic for us to see a better way to reach our students through dialogue, questions, and a great conversation. So thank you for your inspiring example. Really appreciate it. And I just want to now go to the very mundane. Please refer to the program, and you'll see that we're going to reconvene at 7 o'clock for Professor Neil Gross's talk. And also, you have surveys. You have something to fill out there. Let us know what you think of a program like this and of a discussion. And should we have more of these? I'm for bringing you back, myself. Anyway, thank you very much. We'll reconvene at 7 o'clock.